Thank you, ladies. Our keynote speaker is here. Prior to her election as AFT president in 2008, tonight's keynote speaker served for 12 years as president of the United Federation of Teachers, Local 2, representing approximately 200,000 educators in the New York City public school system, as well as home child care providers and other workers in health, law, and education. Since becoming AFT president, she has launched major efforts to place real education reform high on the nation's and her union's agenda. She promotes what she calls solution-driven unionism, an approach to collective bargaining and collective action that unites the interests of union members and those they serve in the pursuit of solutions that benefit students, schools, and communities. Under her leadership, the AFT continues to grow and expand its voice as a union of professionals. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome AFT President Randy Weingarten.
So hopefully I have a voice. I am so glad to be here the day after Janice. Yeah. I have four words. Don't count us out. Don't count us out. Can I hear you say it? Don't count us out. Oh my God, I can't hear today, but I can't hear you yet. Don't count us out. And before I go into my speech, I actually wanted to formally present the AFT PSRP Organizing Award to your three officers. So may I do this? This award is about is for growth. Can you hear me or do I need to do this?
We'll get closer.
Oh, great. What this award is about growth. And what OSEA has done this year is basically to spit in the eye of the right-wing conservatives who want us dead. And that is what you did by growing. My numbers are now wrong. I heard it's 200 more than my numbers, but my numbers were 3,517. I hear now it's up to 3,700. This is why I say don't count us out. There has been a long history of a lot of people who were in OSEA who got the benefits but were not members, were agency fee payers. And this year, you, in your member-to-member drives, basically did the kind of engagement of making the union a family, of people seeing the union as an investment. And what happened is more and more people have joined and have become members. And that's why I wanted to actually honor OSEA with the AFT PSRP Organizing Award this year. Thank you. And this is the first speech I'm actually making since Janice, since the decision came down yesterday. And, you know, I do have a rule that I try not to curse south of Philadelphia. Now, I know we are a little west of Philadelphia, And I know, you know, but I did try several times in reading through my notes to take out every curse word that I wanted to put in here. But I will have a swear jar at the AFT convention because I'm sure I am not going to be able to contain myself by the middle of July. And I'm going to start that swear jar with $50 in it so that I can do a lot of cursing. Yes, I know teachers are not supposed to curse, but this is the kind of time we are in. So, you know, when Tim invited me to come, it was months and months ago, and I was going to start my speech by saying, look, it's been 10 years of AFT and OSEA together, and look where we are. We have a member-driven, member-run union where we have done together all sorts of great things, and on and on and on. It feels like that would be a little sugar-coating if I started the speech that way today. So I'm telling you what I was supposed to say, and I kind of ripped that up and wrote my own, which is that we are really in a which side are you on moment in as true a way as I think we've ever been in kind of the modern generation. Think about it. We really are living in two countries right now, and I think you see it a lot in Oregon, the difference between the west side of the state and the east side of the state. You have a federal government controlled by one party that in the last few months have lavished big tax cuts on corporations and billionaires. I call them gazillionaires. I think that's millionaires and billionaires together. And then they use that to slash spending on public schools and services. And you see that in the national government, and you see that in many, many states. You have the worst Secretary of Education ever, who is not just anti-public education, but basically wants to privatize anything that anyone has ever done for the public. And that's not enough for her. She has aggressively opened up her department to predatory loan servicing and to for-profit colleges. I should actually say her name because I hope it will evoke something. That's Betsy DeVos. Betsy DeVos. And the one we all know is that just yesterday, the slim majority on the Supreme Court took a hatchet to labor unions in the Janus v. Aspe case. And I just, you know, I don't practice law much anymore, but this paragraph in Justice Kagan's dissent is one for the books. And she said, it's on page 26 if anybody wants to see it, there is no sugarcoating today's opinion. The majority overthrows a decision entrenched in this nation's law and in its economic life for over 40 years. As a result, it prevents the American people acting through their state and local officials from making important choices about workplace governance. And it does so by weaponizing the First Amendment in a way that unleashes judges now and in the future to intervene in economic and regulatory policy. This is the Supreme Court justice, not me, talking about how they have weaponized the First Amendment and just thrown out precedent because they didn't like it. And I won't even talk, you'll notice, much about the president. I will probably not even say his name. The only thing I'll say in a minute or two is about the way he treats children. That's on one side. And what's fueling that side is right-wing groups that have pledged to spend and are now spending over $80 million to, their words not mine, defund and defang unions. And then the Koch brothers decided to say that they would up the ante to $400 million so they could undermine public education, again, their words not mine, and break education unions. So why do they want to do this? Think about it. They have a trifecta going on. The Kochs, the DeVosses, and all sorts of corporate allies, like the folks who run Nike. They want three things. Gut public education, gut the right to vote, and gut the labor movement. And why these three things? Because those three things are the vehicle by which regular working folk get ahead. It's the vehicle by which regular folk can thrive, if you think about it. And that they see as a threat to their power, as the demographics of the country are hugely changing, and they're going to try to do everything in their power to pull the world back so that the demographics don't allow diversity and inclusion. That's what's going on in the country on their side. And what about our side? Unions like OSEA, like our national, what we've learned, and you saw it with the teacher strikes this year. You saw it with what happened after Parkland. And I should have actually asked for a moment because of the people who died in Annapolis this afternoon because of yet again a deranged killer. What has happened is that we have learned what the coal miners learned so many years ago, which is together we can accomplish what is impossible to accomplish alone. And you've seen it in Oregon. You, by what you've done since you've had not only Kate Brown in office, but legislators that you can work with. Think about the fighting that you have done against privatization of school transportation or custodial services, or, and I love this, the Work Shouldn't Hurt campaign, that because of your vision, your hard work, yes, we helped a little with a little AFT assistance, but you got Governor Brown to sign it into law to make it effective this year. Because making sure that work is safe, making sure that you aren't safe at work is incredibly important, and you are the ones that got that done in this state. Then the other people on our side are people in Congress. Not everyone, but Senators Merkley and Wyden, and Representatives Bonamici, DeFazio, Schrader, and I can never pronounce his name, Blumenauer. Earl, exactly. Earl the bicyclist. Look, they have helped us. I see this up close. When Betsy DeVos tried to cut every single summer school program, every single after-school program, every single subsidy for climate, for paraprofessionals in her budget last year, they and so many other Democrats came to our aid and were able to leverage what power they had to stop those budget cuts and to actually have some modest increases. And now today, and they invited us to be there, but I said, I'm going to Oregon. Today, they had a press conference announcing what they called the Better Deal Program. And this time, what they've done, and obviously they can't get it done right now, is they took on the Janus decision, and they are trying to make a right for collective bargaining in the federal law for every public employee to try to counteract the decision that just happened. They're on our side. And the other people who are on our side, and you've seen this this year, are school employees all across the nation who are rising up like never before. You know, you expect it in Oregon, you expect it in New York, you expect it in California, you expect it in Washington State, but Arizona, Oklahoma, West Virginia, Colorado, Puerto Rico, Kentucky, like never before, acting like a human shield so that politicians in these states had to respond, and Puerto Rico's a territory, not a state, but had to respond to them, had to respond in a way that dealt with some of these issues. And in every single one of these states, the politicians said, oh no, we're going to wait them out. We're going to, you know, the public would turn around against them. And that didn't happen because people were there to fight for investment, for public education, and the public is with us now. And who else is on our side? Just yesterday, mayors from 50 big cities said they want to bargain with unions. They know that unions create stronger communities, and they are on our side as well. They know that unions are the best vehicle for keeping working families having a stable life, having good wages, having health benefits so that you can stay healthy. And if you're sick, not be one illness away from bankruptcy. They know, even when they are our bosses, that you have to have a union that has a voice for people. So when the boss gets grouchy, you don't have to cower. They know that. People are on our side. But this is the race that we're in. Because unions help not only at the bargaining table and at the ballot box, but they help make America better when unions have density. And that is what the right wing is against us about. Because they know, like you know, that unions make possible what is impossible for individuals acting alone. And they want people to have to act alone. That's why they fight us in voting, in public education, and in bargaining. Let me talk about bargaining for a second. You know this pretty well. As I was doing a little bit of research, 140 bargained contracts in OSEA. 140 contracts. What does that mean? The point was driven home to me about what that means, frankly, a couple of weeks ago in a hospital room. And I told the board this story. I'll probably tell this story at the convention too. I don't normally talk about my life because I don't think it's really relevant, but my dad fell, broke his femur bone, and he wasn't doing well. And we called all of our cousins because we thought he was going to die that weekend. And so my cousin is sitting with us. He's better, knock wood, and he's in rehab now because my dad, who's 90, has probably 10 lives. So my cousin, she's a school teacher, elementary school teacher on Long Island. So she's with us. We're sitting with my dad in ICU. He's in bed. And she's talking to me about her local. Now, she has never talked to me about the union, ever. And so we're sitting here. She's talking to me about the union. And I'm like, oh, my God, what's this about? And so she said that that week, her local leader held up two things. One was their contract, and the other was a piece of paper from Texas. Now, their contract had wages, health benefits, retirement benefits, and lots of clauses pertaining to working conditions and to fairness. Kind of, sort of like the 140 contracts you have. The other piece of paper basically said the contract of a teacher in Texas. And it basically said what the salary was, and that that teacher could be fired for any reason or no reason at all at any time during the year. And as she was telling me that story, it reminded me of how the head of the Texas Federation, who Tim and I know well, Louis Malfaro, said to my local a year ago, "We really want to be like you. We don't want you to be like Texas. We want more New Yorks and less Texases when it comes to labor relations." And so I'm waiting to hear what the rest of the story is from my cousin. And she said after the presentation of her local leader, everyone in the room signed a new union card. In fact, and I was telling this to the board before, in the last 5 months, 530,000 people of the 800,000 members in the AFT that are affected directly by Janus, 530,000 of them, before the decision was rendered, had already signed new union cards. And in fact, NYSET is up to 80%, Minnesota is up to 99%, Illinois is in the 90s. And that is why you saw on social media the day of the decision. And that's why I'm saying don't count us out. And you saw these pictures of people all over the country saying, "I'm sticking with the union." It's why we are at the highest numbers ever, 1.755 million, 3,700 new people in OSCA since October. But this is the reason I told you the story. Because then my cousin said to me, and this time I was like, then she says to me, she's becoming more involved in the union. She volunteered to talk to the newer members, explaining how we could lose everything, everything that that local built. And I started tearing up. Because in that story, I saw her transformation. She was telling me what she was doing, not asking me what I could do for her, but telling me what she and her colleagues were doing for themselves and what they saw as the stakes and the import. That's the transformation that is happening in our union coast to coast. And that is what the other side wants to kill. Because they know, like we do, member-to-member connections make us stronger. And they know when it is members with members, like Terry Jones, like Denise Chase, like Angie Whitmer. I assume that you guys are in the audience. Like Nicole Lando, like Gail Barlow, like Tim Stevens. Some of your volunteers who have done these member-to-member conversations. People start feeling that engagement. They start seeing that their values are reflected in what the union does, and the union becomes, not in rhetoric, a vehicle for a better life, but in reality, a vehicle for a better life, the only institution that really has people's back. That's what I am seeing all across the country in the last few months, and that is why I say to you, and I say to the right wing, don't count us out. Now, why do they find us so threatening? Because everything we are about, they hate. They don't want people to have living wages. They don't want people to have good retirement. They don't want people to have a voice at work. They don't want people to have health care so that you're not one illness away from bankruptcy. They don't want people to have good public schools or affordable college or the fight against bigotry and hate. And they want themselves, not anyone else, to be involved in the democracy. So this is what they are trying to do, because they know that the states that are right to work, they know those states are the ones that made the deepest cuts in public education. They know those states have the lowest wages. So they're trying to make everything like those states. And our job is to fight that every which way we can. But to do that, we have to know what they're doing. So the anti-union groups are zeroing in on the West Coast, particularly Oregon, California, and Washington. They have an entity that's called or misnamed the Freedom Foundation, which has trained and hired and trained 80 canvassers to go door to door to visit any government building where public employees work, trying to convince people to drop their union dues. And they'll use words like opt out, disaffiliate, get yourself a raise, et cetera, et cetera. And their goal is to shrink unions in these three states by 127,000 members. How they got to 127,000, I don't know. But that is their goal. And in fact, they've already sued AFSCME in Oregon. And they've already started, we saw today, an opt-out campaign in the Portland chapter. Have any of you also seen their campaigns? Show of hands. So I suspect you're going to see them all across the state. So this is what they're trying to do. They are trying to create disruption and destabilization so everyone will have to fend for themselves. We've seen their documents. We have an amazing research department that now tracks all of this. They want local unions to break away from state and national unions so that everything gets diffused and diluted, a union here, a union there, not a union movement. And they want millions of workers to try to make it on their own. They're going to try to say, see, you can get a raise yourself by your own, by yourself, by dropping your union dues. And what they're trying to do is do that all across the country, particularly in the states that have real power. And they're doing it through social media, mail, email, television ads, and phone calls. And they've already set up a website with automated systems for workers to generate letters to their unions opting out. The reason I'm saying all this to you is because none of us can hide. It's going to happen all over the place. But this is the great irony of their rhetoric. Workers covered by union contracts earn about 14% more on average than non-union workers. And workers on a union contract have health benefits and some retirement benefits, which non-union workers don't. And if you need any proof, look at Wisconsin. After the governor, Governor Walker, and the state legislature passed a law stripping public employees of most of their collective bargaining rights, this is what happened. Teachers across the state, paraprofessionals across the state, took a $10,000 haircut, $5,000 in health benefits, and $5,000 in retirement benefits. We have all of this in video. We have all of this in tape. We have all of this if you need it to engage people, show people. But that's the point. We know this. They know this. This is not a race. This is a way of having, as our Texas leader said, a race to the bottom. Now, let me tell you, as I end, what's happened in the states where this has happened already. I have no doubt that there have been people who have knocked on the OSCA offices in the last 24 hours and said, I want to drop my union. But in the last 24 hours, we've had people come into the Illinois higher education offices and say, here's my union cards. As I said before, we've had people all across the country do social media. Union, the word union was trending all day yesterday, as much as Kennedy resignation. In LA, the Freedom Foundation, this same group, sent letters to every single member of our local in LA, in UTLA, 34,000. You know how many people dropped after these letters? We see this in a recent AFT poll that we did, oversampling members all across the country. We threw out to people every argument that the other side was doing, every single one of them. After every argument was thrown out, almost 90%, 89% said they were sticking with the union. And in terms of local and state, and these are not people that had one-to-one conversations. In terms of local and national unions and what our members think, over 74% to 4% said, I want to be in the national union, and over 70% says, I'm sticking with my local union. I tell you all that because we know that when we engage members in the work that we know they need, when they see themselves in the union, they know that together they can accomplish what is impossible to accomplish alone. And that is why we try to do everything we can to stick together, and why this national union, if you want it, will always, 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 always have your back. The last thing I want to say is this. There's a lot of other things to talk about. We have to make community our new density. We have to win elections. But you do a whole lot in terms of making community our new density. Look at what you've done in terms of the partnership with First Book. OSEA has provided more than 160,000 free and low-cost books, not only to members, but families and community partners serving children all throughout Oregon. And when you have a book, I see somebody who loves First Book over there, when you give a book to a child, when you unlock that, parents never, ever, ever forget that. And speaking of children, and this is probably the one political thing I will say, and my apologies in advance, is this. We are a country that believes in family values. We are a country that believes in nurturing family. Every one of you works with and for children. And that is why your national union is taking a very hard stand against separating children from their parents at the border and caging children. My grandparents came from the Ukraine. They escaped persecution. Many members of my family were killed in genocide in the Holocaust. We need to make America better than this. We need to make sure America doesn't get into this dehumanizing, degrading of people. That's what we mean when we say we must fight hatred and bigotry. Because if not us, who? And if not now, when? So let me just conclude by saying this. It is a which side are you on moment. It is a bizarre, surreal tale of two countries. People are shaken up, but people are woke. There is a sense that despair is not a strategy. Acting is a strategy. I've not ever seen in my lifetime the kind of activism that there is now. And our challenge is this. Can we build on what you have done in creating 3,700 new members? Can we build on this energy to our states and our country to turn it around, to have a sense of a better life, that together we can do what is impossible alone? The public is with us. Our members are with us. The question is, to all of you, do we have the confidence in ourselves that we can weather this storm and not just come out the other side, but come out stronger? I have the confidence in all of us that we can. I would not be here saying, don't count us out, if I didn't see all that I just said to you. But we need to have the confidence together that that right wing who wants to undermine unions and end the ability to collectively bargain and to have us engage in the political process, we need to be able to say to them, don't count us out. Thank you. So, you ready? You ready? You ready?